We'll have that story for you shortly. But first, if polling trends are to be believed, New Zealand First is set once again to make a return to Parliament. What's more, Winston Peters and his party may soon be in a position to form a support agreement with National and shape the next government. Winston Peters, kia ora, good morning.
Good morning.
I want to start with policy this morning. New Zealand First will establish a dedicated gang prison. How many prisoners will that hold?
Well, it'll hold the number that's required to be held, because what we don't want to do is see the recruiting going on in prisons now. And the corrections officers tell me it's totally possible. Mm. It'll actually work. And so I believe them because of their experience. We're also going to make sure we increase their correctional capacity as well. But we're going to not go on any further with a recruitment process which is destructive to young Māori, particularly first in prison, who are then coming out as full, ready to be graduated as full gang members.
So how many people will it hold?
We'll hold the required number that there is now.
And what is the required number?
If you just go and have a look now, this is not complex. Mm. Ask yourself how many gang members are in prisons now.
I'm asking you, how many gang members are there in prison now?
Well, it depends what grad you talk about. Are they new?
How many gang-affiliated prisoners are there in New Zealand prisons, according to Corrections now?
No one has that record.
Oh, Corrections does. 2,700.
Oh, I thought it'd be more than that.
Oh, OK. Well, you could explain that.
Well, I would have thought it'd been 3,000 at the very least. Mm. But when I talked to them, they said they weren't certain of them. That's why I'm not giving you an answer now.
Mm. So you're going to build a new prison to hold 3,000 people?
We're going to have people in prison building prisons, like I saw offshore in Greenville, South Carolina. Mm. And I thought, this is great. Now we've got people getting skills, they're working, and they're actually doing something for society.
You're going to build a prison that will hold 3,000 people?
No, we're going to get people building units, type of security prefab units that I saw internationally. Mm. And it's a wonderful idea, and you've got people coming out now with some skills to take a job when they get out.
So
prison's about punishment and rehabilitation.
So you think we need to hold 3,000 prisoners? So that would be three Mount Eden prisons, three Remutaka prisons? How much will it cost to implement this policy?
Well, much less than it's costing now.
How much will it cost?
Oh, look, I'm not going to sit here and have a fiscal argument with you when you don't know what you're talking about. The prison officers that I saw, back New Zealand's first proposal, they said it will work. And if it happens, they say we will have far less reoffending.
Mr. Peters, it's entirely reasonable in an election campaign, given this is your policy, to ask how much these new prisons will cost.
Look, if you knew that, you would know that Kelvin Davis...
Do you not know that?
Kelvin Davis has been asked that question and he doesn't know.
I'm asking you. It's your policy, Mr.
Peters. No, if the minister in charge of corrections doesn't know and the system doesn't know, how would you know?
How much does it cost to hold a prisoner a year?
Well, now, that varies between 125,000 to, they say, 195,000, 200,000.
Right.
Now, that cost, that variable is of concern to me because it's far too big a range.
So how much does it cost to hold a prison, to build a prison that would hold 3,000 people?
The fact of the matter is that there are prisons now can do that as we speak. We've just got to make sure we assign them to there.
Mm. Oh, so you're not actually going to develop a new prison? You're going to reassign
Work it out, Jack.
Doesn't sound like there's a lot of detail in this policy.
Work it out, Jack. There are 2,000 spare beds now in our prisons. Mm. So we've got more than two-thirds of the way there already, just as we speak.
So
now, if you take out from one prison that capacity, you're going to get there. But when Mr. Davis was asked this question, the minister in charge of corrections, not you, he didn't know.
Mr. Peters, this is your policy. I asked you how many prisoners in New Zealand had gang affiliations. You didn't know. I asked you how much it would cost. You didn't
know. I said to you that it was 3,000. You say it's 2,700. I don't believe that.
Actually, the record will show that you said that information doesn't exist, and I checked with
the
agents.
Well, no.
It does exist. I've got another question for you regarding another policy.
Stop right here. I'm not going to be talked over here. I've been going to prisons as a young lawyer from a long time, watching and seeing prisoners and seeing Bremerham and all around this country and doing it internationally. The prison officers, when I spoke to them, they said they don't know exactly, but they thought it was that figure, and that's why I wasn't going to go and use it.
It's surprising, given your experience in prisons, that you wouldn't have developed some sort of fiscal detail around a policy of this significance.
Well, I have, actually.
OK, well, how much will it cost?
The fact is, there won't be greater cost.
How much will it cost?
Can I just say...
No, you can't.
No, we
you
won't
can tell
have
us how much it will cost. This is your policy. You've complained in this campaign
look,
already.
Look, I'm not here having...
You've complained in this campaign already that people
don't mind,
haven't
you
asked
don't
you
mind.
About detail
we
of
won't
policies.
Have amateur hour based on what you don't know.
By all means, Mr. Peters,
I'm answering you. Well, if you'll just keep quiet for a second, take a Valium, and realise we're only 2 weeks away from an election. If the corrections officers didn't know with certainty, if the Minister of Corrections didn't know at all, then how can you be so certain of that? And that's my point. There's so much going on in this election campaign where the numbers are being thrown around and they're not true.
Perhaps then you can give us some more certainty with this policy. New Zealand First will fund residential care for the aged. How many people will you fund?
Well, the reality is that you've got these concerns. First of all, you've got 63,000 caregivers in residential age. Some have been working for 25 years on the minimum wage. All these figures have to be you have to go through regional care by regional care. The certainty of that is not known.
So the question I asked was how many people will you fund? Your policy, New Zealand First will fund residential care for the aged. How many people will you fund?
I've just given you the figure of care workers alone, and I can't...
I'm not asking about care workers. I'm asking about the aged people who will receive the care. How many people will receive the care?
Well, if you had any understanding of the situation, it's the people that care for them that are going to be the cost, aren't they? That's the figure. And I've looked at
But the cost is entirely dependent on how many people they're caring for. So my question is, how many people do you anticipate caring for under this policy, your policy?
There's a range of aged care. Do you not know that?
Mr. Peters, it's a straight question. It's deserving
You're not going to sit here like an amateur hour, not knowing the facts. As a former treasurer, I do understand the subject.
Very good. There's you'll be happy to share with us some of your costing.
Can I finish off?
You can tell us how much this policy will cost.
Could I just finish off?
You can tell us how much the policy will cost.
Can I finish off my answer?
If you please tell us how much the policy will cost. Can I just tell
TV1, you're a taxpayer-owned operation. The taxpayers are entitled to have a proper interview here, not you thinking you're going to do what you did last time.
Mr. Peters,
now, can I just say
it's a straight question.
I'm going to ask you a straight question if you'll shut up for 5 seconds. Would you do that? Tell me you're going to do that before I answer.
Mr. Peters, it is a straight question.
Are you going to keep quiet while I answer the question?
OK, according to Eldon, average cost
per
person
is
$1,400 a year.
We're not moving on.
So there are currently 865,000 New Zealanders over the age of 65. So if just 10% of the over 65 population receive residential care as per your one sentence policy, New Zealand First will fund residential care for the aged, the cost to New Zealand taxpayers would be $6.2 billion a year.
It is extraordinary. You didn't even wait for the answer. The answer is there's a range of residential care. Go and have a look out there. There are some that are hard up against it and are collapsing as we speak. You've got all sorts of care systems which they cannot get staff. They're all in a crisis, and we have said that we're going to look at that and find the gaps in the system and attempt to fix that up. Now, that cannot be answered in the way that you just answered it.
There is no fiscal detail in that policy, is there, Mr. Peters?
Well, our manifesto comes out later today. Why don't you wait? We've made sure that we're going to have it out. Given the huge preview gaps and holes there are, we made sure that we're going to make sure ours stacks up. But, of course, you couldn't wait. You didn't ask me to do it.
Will that include a fiscal plan?
You didn't ask me whether we had a manifesto.
Mr. Peters, I asked you how many prisoners you would hold in your new prisons. You couldn't answer. I asked you how much it would cost. You couldn't answer. I asked you how many people you would care for in your residential care policy. You couldn't answer. I asked you how much it would cost. You couldn't answer. I want to talk about co-governance.
I'm sorry, Jack.
I'm going to talk about co-governance.
You're not going to get past me.
A centrepiece of
your campaign.
You're not going
to get past me with bulldust. I could answer, but you had the answer that wasn't correct.
A centrepiece of your campaign is your opposition to co-governance. When you were Deputy Prime Minister, why did your government commission the He Puapua report?
It was a requirement that of signing up to the UN Declaration, which I stopped in 2007, which John Key and Peter Sharple signed up in 2010, that we had to report back to the UN about what we were doing. It was the report to be commissioned and then shown to guess who? The person dealing with the United Nations is the Foreign Minister, me. And it never was, and Willie Jackson told you all why he kept it away from us.
Let's have a look, because we've got a cabinet paper here from 2019. So this is a cabinet paper, a minute from a cabinet subcommittee. You can see the New Zealand's progress on the United Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, development of a national plan. And it says that the committee agrees to establish a technical working group, including non-governmental experts on human and Indigenous rights, and notes that the working group will provide the minister with advice and recommendations on the form and content of a declaration plan. And so let's see who was present in the room.
I was
when
there.
That was at
I was
top
there,
of the
Jack,
list.
Stop being a smart aleck. I was there.
Yeah.
And I've said it. And my next question to you was, Why was it not shown to me?
I'm the one asking the questions. I mean, perhaps that's
a question. Try and ask them sensibly. Well,
there's a good question.
Clever.
Why, when that cabinet paper very clearly says the report was due back in August of 2019, why would a genuinely concerned, diligent, competent minister not demanded to have seen the report at that point?
Ah, look, this is a waste of everybody's time. This is a waste of your question. This is a waste of your viewers' time. This is contempt for the democratic process. Let me tell you what happened.
Mr. Peters,
report was hidden from me and didn't come out until a month after the 2020 election. These are the facts. When Willie Jackson was asked, why didn't you show Winston, he said, well, you know what, he would have done it, wouldn't you? And this man here, standing here right now, trying to defy gravity, trying to defy fact, trying to get a lie out there and expects the public of New Zealand to believe it.
Mr. Peters...
I believe Willie Jackson. He's got no reason to hide the truth.
Mr. Peters, you blame Willie Jackson for not sharing He Pūapua. But what about your role in this? Wouldn't a diligent minister who was concerned about co-governance have chased up the report while in cabinet?
So I was concerned about co-governance. I'm opposed to co-governance.
Exactly. You are opposed to co-governance.
Yeah, but this was not about co-governance until it appeared in its full completion. And when it's completed, it was about co-governance, which is why they didn't ever show me, Jack.
When you were in cabinet, had the opportunity to chase up the report.
Oh, this
you didn't
is ridiculous.
Okay. Mr. Peters.
So some report is meant to be ready by August and it's not there, and that's my number one priority?
I would have thought, given your opposition to co-governance, it would be.
Don't show your gross inexperience.
Mr. Peters, if you're so opposed
to
co-governance...
Don't show your gross inexperience.
Why did your
Everybody,
government...
even the Prime Minister at the time admits she didn't show me. And you're on the show trying to tell people I did know.
You see, you're putting this responsibility on other people. You were the Deputy Prime Minister.
Move on.
One of New Zealand's most experienced politicians.
You're not going to win this campaign.
What does it say about the aptitude and competence...
You're not
going to
win this campaign, Jack.
..of a serious minister...
Jack, you're
if
not
they
gonna,
would not chase up something
Jack,
of that significance.
I know you're desperate, but you're not going to stop this surge in our campaign now with lies and deceit.
Mr. Peters...
I'm sad to see that you're part of it now.
Mr. Peters, I think we all understand the tactic. You come in here, you huff and puff and hurl insults around. I get it. For people at home, it might be entertaining.
These are
serious times worthy of serious leadership. If you are unable to answer straight questions about your policy, your competence and your integrity... That's on you.
The He Pūapua matter has been out there for months. It's all been answered. No one's arguing, excepting Jack Tame and TVNZ. What a waste of taxpayers' money you are.
Winston Peters, if you were so opposed to co-governance, why did your government oversee the earliest stages of co-governance provisions in Three Waters?
Oh, here we go. This is amazing. We've got a crisis in Hastings. People are dying. And people are looking at the provisioning water around this country. It turned out from being an investigation into serious water deficiencies into an ownership takeover, clear as daylight.
Yeah, so why didn't you stop it when you were in government?
Because it wasn't provisioned in that way when it first was started.
Here's a report from the Infrastructure Commission in 2020, when you were still in government, quote, the design of a new framework for the water
sector...
What date
is it? 2020.
September 2020.
September 2020. We're all out campaigning. No one's seeing it because cabinet has risen.
But you'll see if you allow me to read the quote. Clearly these conversations
cabinet has
were already
risen.
Happening.
Cabinet has risen. We're off to an election.
The design of a new framework for the water sector provides a rare opportunity for Te Ao Māori to be embedded at a foundational level in the new utility organisations, e.g. boards of directors. Wouldn't a concerned, competent, attentive minister have intervened?
If that was the matter that was being decided on then, that is the election period. We're all off campaigning. And, as I recall, I think at that time we were in lockdown. Now, we were in lockdown. I'm forced to go back to the beach. I can't even do anything, can't even campaign. Don't you remember that?
Well, one would think that Deputy Prime Minister
you've just
in
been
cabinet,
caught out.
You would be attentive to
you've
those
just
things.
Been caught out.
So, Mr. Peters, when it comes to co-governments, you've said one thing, even though you were in the room when He Pūapua was commissioned. The same applies to funding. So, in the 2020
election campaign... You lied about
that
and you're lying about this.
In the 2020 election campaign, which you are clearly recalling well, you said, quote, we can't just go on running the country for the big end of town. 3 years on, look at your party's donations... shows you've taken almost $900,000 in big donations this year alone, including hundreds of thousands of dollars in donations from some of the richest people in New Zealand. What changed?
Oh, this is amazing. Jack, take your dirt and go somewhere else. I tell me this, we're getting less money than the Greens.
$900,000?
We are getting less money than the Greens. Excuse me, you know that. We're getting one for every dollar we've got.
That'll be a question for the Greens as well. They can answer that. James Shaw
will
be here very shortly.
My question is for you. I'm getting in first to tell you that you're on a muckraking campaign and you're bound to fail.
Quote, we can't just go on running the country for the big end of town. That's the same politician who's taken $900,000 from big donations.
You said that, and that is piecemeal compared with what they've given to the ACT Party. And funded by Parliament as well, they've had $10 for every dollar we've got.
So what do those rich listers want for their money?
The bigger part?
What do those rich listers who've donated to your party want for their money?
We're not corrupt like you. You're on this program trying to get rid of New Zealand First because your masters told you to.
I'm asking.
I got news for you, Jack, and your masters. The people out there will decide this election, and the news for your masters is all bad.
How much money has New Zealand First received this year from people who have or have previously had interests in the racing industry?
We wouldn't have picked up 1/9 of that amount of money, you say.
So I've just gone through your donations. September 12th. These are people who are either connected to the racing industry or... These are people who own horses or breed horses. So let's go through those. So September 12th, you received two donations of $50,000. The 11th of August, $100,000. 10th of July, $50,000.
From the racing industry.
The 14th of April, $50,000. Those are donations from people...
No, you started out with the racing industry, and now you're out lying saying we've received $300,000 from the racing industry. That's not false.
Those are people who have or have previously had interest in the racing industry.
No, sorry, you got caught out there. Big time.
How so?
I told you 1/9 has come in from them, which is a very small amount, I might add. But you're out there saying all this money's come from the racing industry, and again, you've been caught out.
If you make it into
government...
What
a waste of my time is to be here.
Do you intend to promote tax breaks or government funding that could financially benefit people connected to the racing industry?
No, I've never done that.
When you were last in government, you used the Provincial Growth Fund to fund three synthetic racetracks at a cost to taxpayers of more than $10 million. And here's a quote from government officials at the time. Quote, the proposed Riccarton Park synthetic racetrack is located in Christchurch City, which is ineligible for PGF funding. You and Cabinet still signed it off. You gave a tax break to the racing industry worth almost $5 million. So will you oppose any new funding or tax breaks for the racing industry?
This is astonishing. Jack, you're being exposed for the dirt merchant you are. It's so sad.
It's a simple question.
You know, last time I was here before the last election, you made a series of allegations, which in two dramatic court cases we destroyed, but you're not apologising to me today.
Will you oppose...
You're back on the same dirt message.
Will you oppose
I want to apologise to New Zealand's watching this, because this is not the way politics should be run. It should be about people having a chance.
The way that politics should be run in a democracy, Mr. Peters, is that those who are in powerful positions or wish to be in powerful positions should answer straight
questions.
We're
going to start with you.
Being put to them on behalf of the New Zealand people.
How much have they wasted on the merger?
Mr. Peters,
how many hundreds of millions have they wasted on the merger?
Do you accept?
Let's tell the public.
Given
that
you have received hundreds of thousands of dollars from people who are in some way connected to the racing industry.
I have not received.
Do you believe it would be?
I told you we have not received hundreds of thousands of dollars in this campaign from the racing industry, and still you're standing there arguing and misleading New Zealanders.
Will you recuse yourself from any government matters related to racing?
Oh, listen, I think. It's better that I just tell you that there's things like this. This is a manifesto for Auckland. This is a city in absolute crisis. I'd like to talk about
Mr. Peters, no, I've asked you...
It's going to be all about Jack Tame program called Q&A.
Mr. Peters...
And I'm disappointed because New Zealanders deserve far better than that in this campaign, and I tell you what, in the next 2 weeks, they're going to get it. They're going to get some accountability from these people who think that they are in control.
I'm glad that you are so concerned with accountability. Will you recuse yourself from any government matters concerning racing?
You know, recuse is a legal phrase. You know what it means?
Yeah. Please.
Yes. No, you don't know what it means, do you? Recuse is when you've got an interest personal, and I haven't got one.
Okay.
I don't own a racehorse. I believe in an industry that should be $3.5 billion and it's only $1.6 billion. It employs 32,000 people.
And you don't believe that your past connections...
It's part of real New Zealand.
The donations you have
received... And he's not concerned about that. He's not concerned about the Provincial Growth Fund. He just thinks he knows everything about it. Sad.
Okay.
It's a waste of time.
Mr. Peters, one of your centrepiece policies, number 3 on your election pledges on your website, is an end to vaccine mandates. So what government vaccine mandates are still in place?
Vaccine mandates came in October of 2021, and people were mandated out of their jobs, hospital nurses, doctors, and school teachers. They're out there in their thousands. And those are the ones that were in place all this time. And my point is this. Those people took enormous punishment for their standing up and saying, I don't agree. And they lost their jobs. They lost their income. They've got husbands. They've got wives. They've got children. No one cared about that. And I want a full-scale inquiry to see that people got treated properly.
So what government mandates are still in place?
Well, Mr. Hipkins the other day said that there were no mandates in the first place, didn't he? That was a lie. He said there was no mandates in the first place. And at the moment...
He didn't say there were no mandates. He said that no one was forced to have a jab, which is true. There were mandates in place. There were mandates
well,
in place.
Well, he lied,
My question for you...
He lied, didn't he?
..are what government vaccine mandates are still in place?
Well, at the moment, there's only this exclusion. There are some medical facilities where if you're not vaccinated, if you're not vaccinated, you can't get a job there.
I want to have
now,
a look...
That sounds like a mandate to me, doesn't it?
Yeah, I want to consider your position.
Or you're going to say they weren't in place at all?
No, your position today is that you oppose vaccine mandates, but in 2021, let's have a look at this, you said on your social media platforms, no jab...
I've owned up to that. No,
means
sorry.
..no dole and no
I
parole.
Didn't put that post up, and the people that put the post up, I said at the time, later on, I'm apologising for that, and thereafter I made sure I did watched every post every day.
So you expect us to believe that somehow someone close enough to you to be trusted with your social media somehow completely misunderstood your position when it comes to vaccine mandates? Understood it so much that even though you opposed vaccine mandates, they put a post up saying no jab means no
parole. I've owned up to it. I said it was a mistake. I said I'm sorry, and I've made sure that it never happened again.
Who was it? Who put up the post?
Well, I'm not going to tell you who that person is.
See, why should we believe that? I've laid out multiple examples where you have said one thing...
Because, Jack, long
done
time
another.
Jack, months ago, I've said that. A long time before you decide you're going to become a Philadelphia lawyer and show how amateur you are.
Why shouldn't I believe that instead...
I had an interview like this yesterday. Unbelievable arrogance of these journalists that don't know what day it is, think they're going to come here and take me to the cleaners. I've got news for you, Jack, and it's all bad.
Have you had that post taken down?
Oh, well, I said at the time...
Have you had the post taken down, Mr. Peters?
I said later on, that post is not my view and I'll make sure it doesn't happen again, that I don't keep a daily surveillance at 9:30 every day. I've made sure of that since then.
I want to finish by asking about
race. What a waste of time you are on this interview.
The
people want to know what the selection is about, the policies, but you've just turned into a vindictive attack.
Mr. Peters, your candidate, Rob Ballantyne, said this about Māori.
I knew we'd go there. He didn't say it about Māori. I stopped lying. He said it about the disease, the virus of co-governance.
I'm going to quote Rob Ballantyne.
You're not going to repeat Hipkins' lie to me as he did the other day.
I'm going to quote Rob Ballantyne here, Mr. Peters.
So he
said this about Māori. Quote, cry if you want to, we don't care, you pushed
it too
far.
He didn't say that about Māori for the umpteenth time, stop lying.
We are the party with the cultural mandate and the courage to cut out your disease and bury you permanently. Does his view represent that?
No, stop lying, Jack. He didn't say that about Māori. He said about the disease and the virus of co-governance, and I've made that speech. In hall after hall, packed to the wall by a stack of Māori in the audience as well, all agreeing with me.
That might make sense, but for one
And we're
one
not going
word,
to have amateur hour with you telling me what Māori thinks.
That might make sense, right? Mr. Peters, that explanation, but for one word. The word is you. I will quote him directly. I've been back and watched the tape. He said, we will bury you permanently. Not bury it, not bury co-governance, not bury the concept, bury you. He was also asked about his comments by staff, and Mr. Ballantyne himself added context. He said this, I was not talking about mainstream Māori, I was talking about the disingenuous Māori elite. It's the likes of Willie Jackson. Rob Ballantyne, when given an opportunity to add context to that statement, agreed that it was about people, not about a concept. That quote was about human beings.
I have spoken to Mr. Ballantyne. He has been going off my speeches. And I've always connected the cancer of the co-governance, which is destructing our democracy, where one vote is no longer the same, connected it to democracy itself, and I've then connected to the people who are out there, these elite self-appointed, like Te Pāri Māori, which is probably going to go down this campaign and won't be in Parliament. Here's Te Pāri Māori making all these demands, right? They say that Māori is 70% of the population, yet they're only polling about 1.5, which means that a mass majority of Māori do not want them.
I'm going to read that
and
quote
you
once
out
more.
There
Mr. Peters,
you're
this
out
is
there,
the quote of your candidate. We are the party
fellow,
with the cultural mandate.
A woke fellow traveller telling me, a Maori.
And the courage.
And
the courage.
Maori with a proud background, what I should be thinking. This is extraordinary.
To cut out your
how
disease.
How arrogant can you be?
And bury you.
How arrogant can you be? It's like yesterday's interview as well. I've got a white person telling a Maori, been here for thousands of years, started the Ngāti Wai Land Retention Committee in one of the biggest
Mr.
land
Peters,
cases ever.
Does your candidate
what Maori
know,
should think?
Does Rob Ballantyne know that it was your decision to put Labor in power that made the Māori elite he wants to bury Willie Jackson, the Minister of Māori Development? Is he aware that it was your decision?
Oh, this is unbelievable. This is unbelievable. My colleagues, for a start, all agreed, having had a talk with Bill English at the very opening of the negotiations, that we were in trouble going with National because there was going to be a spill on. They were out to roll Bill English, and we'd seen it all before. Everybody in my caucus at the time unanimously thought, well, we're in trouble, we've got to do this. And here you are now blaming me for Willie Jackson being the Minister of Māori Affairs.
Well, you chose Labor.
But he never had that in his manifesto.
Right.
And that was never part of our coalition agreement at all. It's what was happening covertly, hidden away from me. And Willie Jackson, bless his cotton socks, has said that. But no, Jack Tame and TVNZ, now not believe Willie, who's got no reason to lie, you prefer to go ahead with the lie, and
Mr.
you're doing
Peters,
it again today.
I have one last question for you.
People are going to say to me, Winston, why did you bother to come here today? And I'm going to say, well, I
Mr.
stopped.
Mr. Peters, we're
going to... Democracy is about hearing both sides of the story, not hearing arrogant, jumped-up, overpaid people think they know more about this country.
Mr. Peters, you have
thank
railed
you, Jack,
against co-governance.
Thank you, Jack. You've just made a hopeless case here.
You've,
good
you've,
case
you've railed
for
against
us
co-governance.
To, for us to make sure we get the broadcasting portfolio after this election.
Is that a threat, Mr. Peters?
No, it's not a threat. It's a promise that you're going to have an operation that's much more improved than what it is now. It's just an idea.
Thank you for your time. Good luck in the campaign.
I believe that, Jack, like I believe half the other bulldust you just said.
New Zealand First Leader Winston Peters. After the break, it's not that long since the Greens were fighting for their party's parliamentary survival, but 2023 is different. James Shaw is with us live next.